B.A.S.E.S. stands for Balance, Agility, Strength, Explosiveness, and Speed. In order, it's the approach used to organize and implement a physical development program to progress properly. Your athletic skills evolve in the same manner in which your physical skills evolve since the day you were born, one phase after the other. Balance is the foundation on which agility, strength, explosiveness, and speed are built. Start with exercises in the still position. Go from no movement to slow movement. Learn to stabilize your body and its joints, and then incorporate agility training. Move your body and its joints properly within their full range of motion before adding heavy weights. Once these movements are mastered, progress by making your exercises more difficult through increased intensity. This can be done in many ways, including the resistance used or the speed at which a movement is performed. With better coordination and improved strength, you can add resistance and speed movement up at the same time to become more explosive. With training, improved balance, agility, strength, and explosiveness will allow you to reach your speed potential. Progressing properly using this approach will allow you to improve all aspects of your game simultaneously and maximize your results safely and effectively. Balance or stability is the body's ability to control the muscles that facilitate effective joint movement. The body's core area is comprised of the hips, torso, and the scapular regions. This area, or what we refer to in baseball and softball as the athlete's batter's box, can be developed by performing multi-joint movements that involve each part of the core. Producing efficient, functional movements in baseball and softball is dependent upon developing a strong core. Exercises without movement build support and durability, whether you're a world-class athlete or a beginner. Balance exercises should be incorporated into every workout. This neuromuscular conditioning helps increase your core stability and stamina, preparing your body to take on intense workouts and game situations. It's essential that you're able to stabilize your body in still positions before factoring in movement.
And we're joined now by our esteemed panel of experts. To my right, renowned speed coach and founder of Velocity Sports Performance, Mr. Lauren Seagrave. Lauren, welcome. To my left, Lovey Jung, an Olympic gold medal winner on the 2004 U.S. Olympic team and current second baseman for the Olympic squad. Welcome. To her left, Dr. Randy Schwartzberg, a sports medicine and orthopedic surgeon, Luke O'Brien, a physical therapist, and last but certainly not least, Miss Natasha Watley, the shortstop on the 2004 Olympic gold medal winner team. Why is balance an important skill that needs to be developed for an athlete?
Well, balance is an interesting aspect of athletic performance, and it's interesting from the fact that it requires a combination of a number of different systems for full function. And when I say that, you need good joint proprioception, and proprioception is the position sense of a joint. And the second, you require muscular strength, and the third is that you require core stability. And from an injury perspective, if I'm to look at an athlete and look at their balance, which is maybe poor, then I know that one of these three systems is probably a little out of whack.
Well, Luke, you know that substandard balance leads to substandard stability. And when an athlete feels like they're out of balance, the nervous system automatically shuts down and doesn't allow you to recruit the same amount of muscle, which means you can't produce the same amount of force and your performance automatically falls off drastically.
Lovey, how does balance work in fielding? You play the infield for the U.S. Olympic team. How does that work?
Balance is every part of our game in the infield, outfield, as well as hitting and pitching. A lot of times we're on our right leg only or on our left leg only or in a different position. And our core needs to be able to be strong and stabilized to be able to be in those awkward positions that our body's not usually supposed to be in and be able to be strong and not get injured from those positions.
You know, in preventing injuries, balance and core stability go hand in hand, and they're very important because, once again, any break in the kinetic chain that we have with the loss of core stability can translate into an injury really in any part of the body, and it really is most pronounced in a baseball or softball player when you look at the shoulder and the elbow. And the reason for that is the shoulder doesn't have genuine inherent stability from the bony parts. The ball of the ball in soccer, or the head of the humerus, and the glenoid or the socket do not have a lot of inherent stability. They can easily move out of place, and they're held in position by the very important capsular ligaments of the shoulder, and also in a dynamic fashion by the small muscles about the shoulder, the rotator cuff and scapular stabilizer muscles. Without those muscles tuned up and firing in a very ergonomic fashion, in a very concentric fashion, in a way that really will hold the shoulder in place, throwing athletes can develop injuries. And that's why it's very important to tune up all those small muscles to create the best dynamic stability for that joint.
Did you know you can strengthen your muscles without actually moving? Introducing a variety of poses challenges the major stabilizers of the body.
The main reason for almost all athletes that yoga is really good for them is injury prevention. Softball and baseball players get really tight hamstrings and shoulders, and you know, so with yoga it really helps. The nice thing about yoga is it really works on flexibility, which isn't normally addressed in most strength training programs, since its primary focus is on flexibility. It stops people from getting injured. Your star players or your players aren't any good for you if they're sitting on the bench injured. I think the number one reason for coaches to do it is the injury prevention.
How does yoga improve an athlete's balance and core stability?
I mean, there are certain poses that you can do that specifically work on balance and core strength, like plank. Also, hover is great for the core. A lot of people think it's arms that are holding you up, but it's actually your core that's holding you up.
Regardless of age, master balance skills before beginning a weightlifting program. As you become more experienced, continue to use your balance program throughout the year as a warm-up to more advanced programs. For more ideas and detailed instruction, visit prosactive.com. Agility is the coordination that allows you to stabilize the body when movement occurs. The best athletes in sport make what they do look so easy. Man, how did he do that? The strongest athlete on the team, though, doesn't always hit the most home runs. What separates the home run leaders from their competitors is that they move more fluidly, so they can then apply the big muscle strength they do have to their tasks on the field. Being big and strong doesn't necessarily mean you're going to become a good athlete. Before a weight room is needed, begin with exercises and drills that can easily be applied anywhere.
Randy, as an orthopedic surgeon, where do you see the most injuries occurring? What part of the body, and how can those be prevented?
In softball and baseball, the most common injuries I see are throwing injuries, and they're going to be to the elbow and the shoulder. And I think that the most common, if I take that to a further subset, are going to be the overhand pitchers. And I think that the best way to prevent that in overhand pitchers is a multi-pronged attack. And that's going to be adequate off-season training with regards to weights, development of the appropriate power base, training these small muscles about the shoulder that we talked about, throwing in the off-season, not throwing too much in the off-season, and then having an off-season, mm-hmm. which is an issue with the youth. When they don't have an off season, that's a problem and a risk factor for injury. And then when the season gets going, appropriate pitch counts.
And Luke, when it comes to injury prevention, what should be the goal for any athlete, no matter what the sport?
The goal should be, one, that they have good core stability. The second point should be that they have adequate muscular strength. And the third is that they have full joint range of motion. In those combinations, then they have the most likely chance of decreasing their injury. There are injuries that can't be helped. Copping a ball from a line drive, from a contact injury, can't be helped. But soft tissue injuries from running down the baseline can be prevented.
Unfamiliar and uncontrolled movement can cause injury. Actively learning how to incorporate the major joint stabilizers of the hip, torso, and shoulder will train your body to move instinctively.
Let's start with the shoulder joint itself. It's a very special joint in the body. It's a ball and socket joint. Several muscles cross this joint, making it very complex. Along with that are the movements of the shoulder joint, flexion and abduction and extension and internal and external rotation, as well as horizontal abduction and adduction, and scaption and overall circumduction of the joint. When you're talking about range of motions, the most important with the shoulder is internal and external rotation. Ideally, you'd like to have 165 to 180 degrees of what we call total arc, and that's the combination of the two together, external and internal. You're going to have a greater external rotation because throwing a baseball, you get a natural external stretch, external rotation stretch, as opposed to internal rotation, where you're going to be shorter on your non-throwing to throwing side. Other muscles that you want to keep monitor closely in regards to flexibility for the throwing shoulder are your pectoralis muscles, your biceps, and your latissimus dorsi. When talking about shoulder stretches or baseball specific stretches, the one we talk about for the shoulders we call the sleeper stretch. The posterior side of the shoulder gets much tighter than the front side because the front side gets that natural stretch. So with this sleeper stretch, you can do it by yourself, lying on a table or standing against a wall, where you would basically lie on your side or stand and drive your chin into the humeral head, securing it, applying pressure to the back side of your hand, where you're internally rotating the shoulder, stretching the back side of the shoulder. Now when talking about the strength of the shoulder, a lot of people go right to the rotator cuff, but it's very important to understand that the scapular musculature and the scapular positioning and the scapula altogether takes priority over the actual shoulder and the rotator cuff. We have a saying called shooting a cannon out of a canoe. And basically what this is if you have a cannon, which would be your shoulder and arm, and you're trying to shoot it out of a canoe, which is a very unstable setting, unstable environment, you don't want the canoe to be your scapula. Okay? The arm, the rotator cuff, works behind the scapula. The cannon, you want to be on a stable ground, cement, solid base. That's what you want your scapula to be like, secure, so the shoulder can work with accuracy and work to maximal strength.
Agility training focuses on improving movement efficiency and reaction times, in turn successfully producing the quick, instinctive reactions required during game situations. Once you're able to do the exercises or drills correctly, increase the intensity by adding resistance or by moving faster. With better stability and coordination, you'll notice quicker improvements. Hitting is simple, right? You just see it and hit it. Well, if only it was that easy. But did you know that you can train to improve your vision? If you want to improve your reaction time, incorporate multiple skills into your training. Quickly coordinating movements to get successful results is why reaction time is an essential component to improving agility, strength, explosiveness, and speed.
Natasha, what kind of warm-ups and stretches do you like to do before a game?
I like to do a lot of dynamic stretching. I like to do a lot of active stretching. I think it's more sport-specific. It's more related to what I'm going to do on the field. It's more related to what I'm going to do when I get in the box. If I'm stretching and moving at the same time, I'm warming up a lot faster and doing it in a shorter amount of time instead of doing a static stretch. And when you do static stretching, I feel like it takes a long time to actually get warm.
What you're looking to do is accomplish a few things, and one of the things you're trying to accomplish is minimize the chances of muscle strains. And it's been shown that when you warm up muscles and when muscles are strong and not in a weakened state, they have a higher threshold for injury to them. So a static stretch really doesn't reproduce what you're doing on the field, whereas an active stretch has a little bit more of a likeness to what you're doing actually on the field. It's more functional.
The traditional way of thinking when you do long hold static stretching prior to speed and power activity switches off the nervous system. And it doesn't allow you to recruit the same amount of muscle. And so consequently, if we did a static stretching program and tested your vertical jump, it would be less than if you just walked in here and did nothing at all. And so to your point, doctor, we don't want to switch the nervous system off, which then weakens the muscles temporarily until the activity of the game reawakens the nervous system. Let's switch the nervous system on with a real strong, active, dynamic warm-up. I don't want anyone to misunderstand this, static stretching is still good, but it perhaps should better be done after the activity to allow the body to come back down and for the muscles to relax so that we can continue to maintain our flexibility.
Luke, how important does post-game stretching then become?
I think post-game stretching definitely helps with your recovery and your ability to recover from the activity that you've performed. To go back to Lauren's point, he talks about active warm-up from a neuromuscular pathway perspective. From an injury perspective, active warm-up increases the temperature in a muscle better than a static stretch. And we know that having a higher temperature muscle is a decreased chance of having a muscle strain or a muscle tear. So from preventing injury, active warm-up, running and movement patterns, it increases the muscle's temperature.
What agility drills can improve an athlete's baseball skills and conditioning?
There are so many out there to choose from. I think there's some good basic ones that we could start with. Simple routine. You're going to go from anywhere from side shuffles to karaokes to backward runs, and just to name a few. Other drills such as a basic T drill, where you run forward, side shuffle to the side shuffle to another side, back to the middle, and then back pedal. Things like that. Just working on basic footwork principles in the game of baseball.
How many of those can be applied to the pregame routine, right before game time, guys are getting ready for the game, and maybe can help them long term?
I think it's a good thing. Again, you're raising the core temperature as well as body temperature and getting ready for the specific movements and demands that the game bring. First, I really think it's imperative to get your core warm and also increasing your hip flexibility, range of motion. So for me, an athlete, I'd have them go and start off with leg swings, going front to back, and then have them do maybe 10 each leg, and then it would switch into opening up or facing a fence or a wall, having you there and having you open up in a leg swing to where you open your hips, the swing open, and through your body and getting your core going there. On an upper body standpoint, we would go into something like maybe tubing or scarecrow exercises where we're just trying to get the arm action to continue to be like the sport-specific thing that's going to be done on the field. Some other things would be trunk rotations, emulating the swing plane, or throwing rotations with med balls, having a guy in a stride position and taking him through a full plane or a motion that he would take making a pitch or making a throw from outfield or infield or what have you there.
There are many ways you can incorporate agility and explosive drills in a team setting. Use them as pregame warm-ups or as conditioning at the end of your practice. Keep it organized by splitting your team into groups and performing drills for specific increments of time and then rotating. For more ideas and detailed instruction, visit prosactive.com. The first step in designing your strength building program is to remind yourself that you're an athlete, not a bodybuilder. Building muscular strength gives the body the ability to create momentum and then stop abruptly. Using external resistance is vital to your athletic development. Once you're able to stabilize and coordinate your body properly, stimulate further muscular development and metabolism by gradually adding outside resistance.
Strength is essential to performance, but even more importantly, that inadequate strength can lead to injury. Mm-hmm. Athletic performance and participating in sports, most commonly for people today, is the most stressful thing that they will do in not only their day, but probably their week and month. And if they have inadequate strength, then during that participation in sport, that they're setting themselves up possibly to become injured. And no matter how good an athlete they are, an injured athlete can never reach their full athletic potential.
In developing athleticism for baseball or softball, focus on functional strength. Doesn't always matter how much you bench press or squat. The key is to develop lean muscle trained to maximize your potential as a baseball or softball player. An example of this is rotational strength. Rotational strength, generated from your core muscles, is used in batting, throwing, and fielding. Lifting heavy weights will not automatically give you a 100-mile-an-hour fastball, but developing functional strength will allow you to maximize your power potential.
Because of our lifestyle, we are seeing much less strong athletes in this generation than we have in generations in the past, because lack of free play, lack of physical work, not many kids out there baling hay today unless you happen to live out in the country, and those natural development of strength have been removed. And so looking at how can we generate the same levels of strength using alternative activities when you're younger, gymnastics and bar work for the upper body, and other types of jumping exercises for the lower body when the athletes are young, before they start moving into a formalized resistance training program, and then once more fully matured, a strength training and a weight training program.
Lovey or Natasha, what age did you start working out, and when did strength training become important to you?
I started working out when I was 18, when I went to college.
Mm-hmm. And that's the same for myself. I didn't do any strength and conditioning until my freshman year at college.
Ask yourself, what high school boys football team does not lift weights? Yeah, there ain't one. What girls high school softball team does lift weights on a regular basis in a year-round program? Very few. And so, particularly if you're a young female athlete, to be able to find a situation where you can receive proper instruction in strength training, it may need to be outside of your school system or working on your own to develop the kind of values you need in order to see the kind of progress and the results that you would desire.
For more, we went out to Velocity Sports Performance and caught up with strength and conditioning coach David Page.
Well, your core is your relay station for all the energy that you generate with your lower body. If there's a weakness there, you will not have the optimal hand speed for applying force to the ball or the bat. And for lower body strength, I think you need to really do things on your feet. I'm not a big believer in machines and things like that. I think doing things that incorporate balance as well as a strength are going to be most beneficial. Off that lunge matrix, we can do a lot of different things. We can add some shoulder work. We can add some balance and some core movements with that too. Step up and down variations, different height boxes, balancing crossover step ups. This works on strength throughout the hips, balance, proprioception, all types of things are going to help you on the field. The last of our basics is the single leg deadlift and different things we do off the single leg deadlift. We can throw in different movement planes off that too, but that's going to work on balance, neuromuscular control, and core strength, as well as hamstring flexibility and strength.
Did you know that you can improve strength without gaining too much size? Keep your weightlifting exercises functional by using multi-joint movements with a full range of motion. To build strength, increase the resistance but keep your volume or total number of repetitions low. To build strength and size, increase the resistance and keep your volume high.
The rotator cuff is made up of a group of four muscles, and we use the acronym SITS, S-I-T-S. Stands for the supraspinatus, the infraspinatus, teres minor, and subscapularis. If you have a nice strong scapula, the humerus bone is secured and it pulls down on the humerus. It allows more room for the rotator cuff to work as the shoulder does its thing, taking it through the throwing motion. If you have a weak scapula, the humeral head rides higher because the humerus is less secure. You have less room where the rotator cuff sits. If you go into throwing or overhead motions, you're going to get more friction, which results in inflammation, shoulder pain. When any of our throwing athletes or baseball players in the weight room, our rule number one is to train the back side of the body more than the front side of the body. Train the muscles that you can't see in the mirror. What this does is it puts our shoulders back, gets us in a better posture position, allows the rotator cuff to work to its full capability as well as the rest of the body. The second weight room rule, control the weight being lifted. Never sacrifice mechanics of an exercise for more weight being lifted. And no bouncing of the weight at end ranges of the exercise. Control the weight. When you're in the weight room, don't forget about your scapular stabilization and rotator cuff exercises. These are small areas and they tend to fall between the cracks during general upper body strength programs. And when incorporating your rotator cuff work, try to make it on throwing days, because if you throw and then the next day you're working your rotator cuff, that means you're working your rotator cuff every day. So you try to pile it up in one day. And again, if you do a lot of throwing, you're going to do less or zero rotator cuff work in your weight program on that day. Recommended exercises for strengthening of the scapular musculature to result in shoulder stability, we start off with retractions, which is simply pinching the shoulder blades back. You can do it seated, standing, with resistance, without resistance. And when you're retracting, you want to make sure that your shoulders do not migrate up into your ears. So it's important that you get a backward movement and a downward movement with your shoulder blades, and not a backward up movement with your shoulder blades. So that's a simple retraction. The progression after that, you could put your hand on a table, just using your throwing side or your non-throwing side together, and just retract, slide, doing what we call table slides. And ultimately what you're doing is strengthening the backside of your body, trying to produce better posture, the scapular musculature, to pull your shoulders back into that position where the rotator cuff can work to its maximal potential. The next exercise, what we call Y, T's, and I's. The first one would have your arms in a Y position. It's a very small movement. All you would do is you start off horizontally and just lift your arms up, retracting your scapula downward and back, hold for 1 to 2 seconds, and release. The stronger your muscles get, the longer you'll be able to hold. You start off doing 5 to 8 reps, work up to 10 to 12 reps. The T position, which you look like a T, you can go palm down or thumbs up. Same thing, small movement, retract, hold the position, and then let the arms come back down to the start. And then the I position, where your arms are down next to your body, palms to the ceiling, retract, lift the arms up, hold for 1 to 2 seconds, and then back down. It's important to remember, these muscles are small, so you're not gonna go into a gym as if you were gonna squat or leg press. You're gonna use just body weight or up to 1 to 5 pounds. Recommended exercises for strengthening of your rotator cuff. We go up in 1 to 2 seconds, and we return back to the start position in a 2 to 3 second, or slower than your primary movement. So the standing, flexion, abduction or abduction, and then thumbs up scaption, with light dumbbells starting, just using the body weight, which is the weight of your hands, progressing up to 5 pounds. The next exercise would be standing as well, resistive tubing exercises, where you would have resistive tubing anchored to a wall or somebody holding it if you have a partner, and working the exercises of external and internal range of motion, extension, horizontal adduction and abduction, we call 90-90 external rotation, and then a D2 pattern, which is actually very similar to throwing motion. You'd have the tubing anchored down below you, pulling back, coming forward. So you'd pull back in 1 to 2 seconds and control it 2 to 3 seconds going back to the start position. That's what we call the D2 or the throwing motion in baseball. A lot of people don't understand that throwing a baseball is exercise for your rotator cuff. So if you're out there throwing tons of baseballs, it doesn't do you any good to come into the weight room and do tons of rotator cuff exercises. It leads to overuse, and overuse leads to fatigue, ultimately maybe an injury, and that's the last thing you want to happen.
Begin with multi-joint exercises which develop strength around the hips and along the spine. Learn to stabilize the joints and move them in proper position. Remember, if you do exercises incorrectly, you're putting yourself at risk for injury now and possibly in the future. Once mastered, continue to use balance and joint stability exercises as your warm-ups, and focus on building additional abdominal and lower back strength through more advanced exercises. For more ideas and detailed instruction, visit prosactive.com. Balance, agility, and strength exercises quickly turn into explosive routines by increasing the speed of movement, allowing you to start, stop, and redirect forces all as quickly as possible.
Luke, along those lines, you rip a double down the third baseline, you go tearing out of the box. If you're not trained for that explosiveness, that's when injuries happen.
Absolutely, and it's not just a one-factor thing. It all comes back to we looked at preparation, we looked at the active warm-up and getting the muscle ready to go, we looked at core stability and how that's going to affect how the energy is transferred through the body, And so all these things come back and create a pattern here of how to prevent injury and maximize performance.
The real key to that is that it starts to train the body so that you can learn how to produce force by using stored elastic energy rather than just muscle contraction, so that you can be more like a super ball instead of a bean bag. And this is real critical whenever you're talking about moving your body from point A to point B.
Did you know the lightest bats aren't always the best if you want to improve your power? A wiffle ball bat swung at a high speed is not going to hit a baseball or a softball over the fence. A heavier bat swung slow will also reduce the distance the ball can travel. The key to maximum power is to find the heaviest bat you can stand.